I want to say one thing too before we get started. It's at the end of November. Thanksgiving is this week, and then December, the end of the year. And I know that you begin to get this time of the year a lot of appeals for year-end giving. Various organizations, most charitable institutions get probably about a third of their income in November, December of the year. And I know you'll hear a lot of those kind of things. And I, you know, you can use your own wisdom about how you spend your money. But I wanted to remind you about what we do here. Nobody's going to support what we do, the preaching of the message of grace, except us. You know, there's a lot of folks who support Billy Graham, Baptists will do that, and lots of people support the Shriners Hospital. Those are all great ministries, but there are people that will support them. Nobody's going to support the preaching of the gospel, the grace of God, but grace believers. So I remind you about that. And I say to you specifically, there are things that we do here that you need to think about. We don't talk about them a lot, so I'm going to say something about it this morning. In the last number of years, we've had special things for the church that we were doing, the parking lot and remodeling and so forth. This year, we're not doing any of that. But I wanted to remind you, we have an extension ministry. Next 2 weeks, I'll be down in Slidell, Louisiana, in a Bible conference. That's the New Orleans area, where I was 2 weeks ago at Brother Lemon's. That outreach ministry that carries our ministry out into the community, into the broader area outside of Chicago, Grace Impact Ministries is what that ministry carries. And that's where Grace School of the Bible, that's where the television ministry and all those things operate under that umbrella. And those ministries actually are, because of the COVID, have suffered financially because of that. One thing today I want to share with you, Brother Des Stridham, you folks know Des, we support the Graceway ministry. This last week, he ordered about $500 worth of material to send to Africa, books, booklets, and so forth, pamphlets, the right division charts, and so forth. And it's going to cost over $400 just to ship. No, he ordered, it was $400 of material. It's going to cost $500 to ship it. And I told him that we would finance that for him. And when I say we, I mean me and you. So there's about $850 that immediately you can think about. Some of you might like to be a part of that. And that would be a good thing. If you want to do that, you can either make a gift out to Grace School of the Bible, which who is going to be doing that, or you can make it out to the church and market for the African ministry, and the brothers will pass it on to Grace School of the Bible because the school will be paying for those things. And that's there. The wall chart that's up here, we just had it reprinted. We had 100 of them. They were delivered on Wednesday. They're $80 a piece to print. And by the way, Debbie said to tell everybody the price is going to go up January the 1st. So if you want one for that price, you better order before the 1st of December, 1st of January. But we just had 100 of those. Now, you can do the math on that. Take 80 times 100, and you figure out how much money that is. We also had about $4,000 worth of reprints, booklets and so forth, that's there. The Grace Journal, I've got a Grace Journal that I've got it ready to go to the printer. The reason we don't put the Grace Journal out every month anymore, we put it out quarterly and now just twice a year, is because it costs about $12,000 for each one. We have a mailing list of about 40,000 people that we send that to, but because of the expense involved in it, we don't do quite as often, and those kind of things. So I just say that to you. Forgotten Truths, I'm up there. I learned that their income this year is behind. They're behind about $15,000. So there's some significant amounts of money that can be put into the work of the ministry. And I say that to you just so you know about it. Otherwise, you see what we do here. You don't see so much about what goes on out there. And there are significant amounts of opportunity to take the Lord's money and put it into the Lord's work. That's, you purpose in your heart how you want to be a part of those things. I just tell you about them, okay? That's the kids. They sing good, don't they? It comes down the hall, okay? Romans chapter 15. Verse number 8, Romans 15, verse 8. And I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. Now you notice there's a colon at the end of that, not a period. And the colon sets up, here he's going to explain what he just said. Here are the promises made unto the fathers. And that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. And again he saith, rejoice, ye Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all ye Gentiles, and laud him, all ye people. And again, Isaiah said, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles trust. Let's pray for a moment. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that the things we look at here today might give clarity of thought in our minds so that our lives might be able to be lived day by day in a clear, consistent demonstration of what you're accomplishing as you form the body of Christ today. We thank you in his name. Amen. You know, we've been talking with you the last several months about dispensational Bible study, about rightly dividing the Word, and about how to study the Bible not based upon a man's estimation, but based upon the way God's Word tells you to do it, since that's the instruction comes out of the Scripture. And we've come in our studies through what the chart would have, time past. We've come to the ministry of Christ here in his earthly ministry. And the Lord Jesus Christ is the most important person in our life. Verse 8, when he says Jesus Christ was a minister, I often stop there and say he's also my Savior. He's also God in human flesh. He's truly God and truly man. He's the unique person of the universe. He's the celebrity of all mankind. He's the rightful king of the universe. He's the one worthy of all of our glory and our worship and our appreciation. So he's someone that we need to know personally and thoroughly and completely. And I can tell you the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that record his earthly ministry, nobody should know more about those books than you and I as grace believers, because we appreciate who he is and what he's done, and we appreciate his ministry. But when you read those books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you listen to what's talked about and preached about the Lord Jesus Christ in the church in general, you have that there's a lot of wild, weird, wacky teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ out of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And it's important to me that you, I'm not worried about them, but that you understand what's going on in the records of his earthly ministry so that when you read them, you can understand and have your feet grounded on truth. This passage is a key passage. In fact, you'll notice on the chart here, I actually have it listed right there. There are three, Romans 15:8 explains Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Romans 11:11 and 12 explains what takes place in the book of Acts with the fall of Israel, salvation of Gentiles. Romans 11:13 explains where we are today, our apostle. And Romans 11:25 talks about the ages to come. It's fascinating how the book of Romans can, you know, it's foundation doctrine for grace, but it also gives you a foundation information about how to understand where we are in dispensationally in the Bible. When you let the Bible be your authority, it's amazing how well it works. And I understand that when you get religion and you get the wild, wacky, weird teachings that come from religion over the transom, sometimes you're studying about the Bible, but not studying the Bible itself. But when you study the Scripture itself, it will teach you what you need to know. If you're willing to question the assumptions that you always had because of what you've always taught, and you're willing to let what the Bible says challenge what you've been taught, the traditions, then you'll find light and clarity. This passage we've studied already about time past, and when he talks about the things that we've learned about time past, this passage demonstrates are still true. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Israel is still the chosen nation of God in the earth. When you read Matthew, things haven't changed. You're simply continuing on with the fact that God, his chosen nation in the earth, is the nation Israel. Verse 10, he says, and he quotes four prophets here. Rejoice, ye Gentiles. You see that next word? With his people. What the kingdom program does, the Abrahamic covenant does, is it extends salvation to the nations through Israel. So Israel still is chosen people. Verse 12, and again, Isaiah saith, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles trust. That's the kingdom program. Gentile salvation is still through the nation Israel in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The goal of the ministry in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is still the establishing the earthly kingdom promised and prophesied in Scripture that's going to be headed up and vested in the nation Israel. That kingdom program, it's prophesied back here. Then it's at hand in here. We're going to study about that. When it comes at hand, there's a new stage in the program. It's still the same program. It's postponed today, and it's going to be fulfilled, set up in the ages to come. But when you come into Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you need to understand where you are. Israel is still God's chosen nation in the earth. The Gentile salvation is still available only through Israel. That's why it's only Israel being focused on there, because they have to be redeemed first. And the goal is still the establishment of a literal, physical, visible, earthly kingdom that's been prophesied all through Scripture up to this point. And by the way, one other thing. The law of Moses is still the operating system back here. It's still the Mosaic covenant. Come with me to Hebrews chapter 9 and get Matthew chapter 5. Hebrews 9. And Matthew chapter 5. The operating system under which the Lord Jesus Christ was born, Galatians chapter 4 says he was made of a woman, made under the law. That is the law covenant that God made with the nation Israel. So when you're reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you're reading information that's given where the operating system that God has in operation at the time is still the Mosaic covenant. You say, but I thought it was the New Testament. No, it's still the Old Testament. Hebrews chapter 9, verse number 16. For where a testament is, there must of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. Jesus Christ died at the end of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So until you come to his death, it's not possible that the New Testament could be a force. It's promised. It's prophesied. It's talked about. He talks about it. But it isn't the operating system until, can't be the operating system until after his death. So when you're reading a passage like Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17, think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot, one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Now, I know what people do. They say, well, that took place at the cross. But listen, folks, all of the law and the prophets weren't fulfilled at the cross. You understand that? There are things that the law prophesied, predicted, required, that aren't accomplished at Calvary. They're not accomplished until the second advent of Christ, the Day of Atonement. The things that the prophets prophesy, they're not all fulfilled at the cross. That's some of the wacky, wild, weird teaching that the church goes. About 97% of Christendom believes in a thing called preterism, a thing called amillennialism, that none of this stuff is real, that all the prophecies of the Old Testament really need to be spiritualized. And you say, well, wait a minute. If he promised Abraham a land and he said, I'm going to give it to you and your seed forever, how long is forever? They say, well, it's just till the book of Joshua. And I go, huh? And the guy says, yeah, but the guy telling me that has got 4 doctorate level degrees and has written 15 books. And I say, so? You understand the shift there? A lot of it depends on who you think the who is, who's telling you what is. Well, when you read those things, you say, then it's, well, who agrees with you? Well, my wife. It's all that really matters, right? That really matters. You got that. But the thing is, the verses is what matters. So when you're in these books back here, come with me. By the way, keep reading, verse number 19. Whoso therefore shall break one of the least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoso shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. So how are you going to have greatness in the kingdom? You're going to follow the law. You're going to follow the commandments. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now that's pretty severe. At the end of the book of Matthew, Jesus takes these same people he's talking to, and he commissions them, and he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them, that you know what I'm talking about. Then what does he say? Commanding them to teach all things, to observe all things I've commanded you. What did he just command them to observe? The law. If you follow the Matthew 28 commission, you are bound by the words of the Lord Jesus Christ in that commission to teach people the law. That's one reason that people don't do what that passage says when they claim they're following it. And that's why people are willing to say, well, it doesn't really mean what it says. And you begin to spiritualize things. And when you spiritualize things, you know the old saying, people spiritualize the scripture because they don't have spiritual eyes. Therefore, they tell spiritual lies. Because if it isn't what it says, you made up a meaning that isn't true. Anyway, come with me to Mark chapter number 1. I just want you to understand when you come into these passages, into Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there is a message, there is something that's going on here. And it's different from what most people think, because most people, the general teaching you get doesn't really reflect the time past. And that's why I've spent as much time as I have trying to talk to you about time past. Because when you come into the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you come into a ministry, you've learned some things. Israel, the nation Israel, is God's chosen nation. They're his agency in the earth through whom he's going to work. The salvation of the nations is going to be accomplished through Israel. And the whole goal is he's going to reclaim the authority of Jesus Christ on planet earth through the instrumentality of a kingdom that's vested in the nation Israel. It's what he's promised and what he's prophesied in Scripture. That's why that passage in Romans 15:9 says, as it is written. It's not the mystery program, it's the prophecy program. And the law system, whether it's the Mosaic law or the Messianic law, it's still going to be, the law is going to be the operating system in that program. Now, if you come to Mark chapter 1, you'll see why this is important. Mark chapter 1, verse 14. And after that John was put into prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. I was traveling, and we went into a little restaurant. My wife likes to stop at Cracker Barrel. You can shop, go to the restroom, and shop. So her favorite place to take a restroom break when we're traveling is Cracker Barrel. And I'm out in the shopping area waiting on her to come out of the restroom and do her shopping, and a gentleman came up and he handed me a gospel tract. We were in Kentucky. And I took it from him, I thanked him, and I stood there and I read it, and at the end, he told you, you're a sinner, you're lost, separated from God, Christ dies for your sins, and what do you need to have eternal life? Repent and believe the gospel. And then it says, you only have to do one thing. Repent and believe the gospel. That's two things. I mean, I can count. So I went and sought him out. I said, which one do I have to do? He said, both. I said, but then it says one. The problem with that verse is, the gospel isn't the gospel of the grace of God. Every time you see gospel in the Bible, the word means good news, glad tidings of great joy, but it doesn't, the reason that you know there's a lot of different, the gospel of the kingdom, this is the gospel of the grace of God. That's two different messages. We'll look at that in a minute. But when John the Baptist comes, he says two things in the verse. The gospel of the kingdom of God is the time is fulfilled. And the kingdom of God is at hand. What's happened there when he says the time is fulfilled? Hold your hand and come back with me to Daniel 9. We've looked at this passage in great detail. So So I just remind you about it. Daniel chapter 9. When Israel went into captivity, the fifth course of judgment in Leviticus 26, when they go off into captivity among the nations, God scatters them among the nations because of their unbelief and disobedience. He tells them, I'm going to bring you back. And he gives them a time schedule for their restoration. Daniel 9:24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and thy holy city. To finish, by the way, that tells you that this is literal. It's not symbolic. Because thy people is Israel in the chapter, thy holy city is Jerusalem. So it starts off telling you, read this literally. To finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, seal up the sum of the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand. Don't you like that? God expects you to understand His Word. Dumb thump like me can understand it. Brilliant geniuses like you obviously can. Know and understand. From the going forth of the commandment to restore and build, rebuild Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince. Notice, not Messiah the King, but Messiah the Prince. The Prince is the boy who would be king. The one who's going to be Messiah is going to show up as the Prince. Shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. And the wall shall be built. The street shall be built again, and the wall even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Notice there's a time schedule, a point in those 70 weeks in which Messiah, the Prince, is going to be manifest. When Mark 1, verse 15, John the Baptist says, the time is fulfilled, he's saying the time schedule for the days of Messiah, the Prince, has arrived. And we studied this in some detail. Those 69 weeks. At exactly the moment when those 69 weeks clicked off to the point where the days of Messiah the Prince to be there, they could identify it. So what he's talking about is the prophetic time clock has reached the point where the Messiah the Prince is to arrive and the kingdom of God is going to be preached as at hand. Now, the idea of preaching it at hand, that's a new phase. Come with me to Luke, hold on to Mark, Luke 16:16. And again, I hope I'm just reviewing in your mind things we've already been over. But when it says the kingdom of God is at hand, that is, there's a new phase of the kingdom program. The next stage in the program has arrived. The next point. You've had all this time back here. You had the rebuilding of the city. You've had the 400 years of silence. Now, the day is of Messiah, the Prince. He's arrived. Prophecy is being ticked off, and the time schedule is here. So the gospel of the kingdom of heaven, the gospel of the kingdom of God, is that the prophetic time clock has come to the point where now the kingdom is at hand. Messiah is here. And a new we're transitioning into the next phase in the program. I've got it on the chart here. The kingdom is prophesied. Now the kingdom is at hand. So we're moving from just it being prophesied, promised, and talked about to actually within the grasp of the nation. Luke 16:16, the law and the prophets were until John. Until John, all Israel had was the prophesying of the law and the prophets about the kingdom. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. So now a new issue is on the table. And that issue is the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, that gospel message. Hold your hand here in Mark and come back with me to Matthew chapter 3. The gospel of the kingdom, Mark calls it the gospel of the kingdom of God. Matthew calls it the gospel of the kingdom of heaven. Those two phrases, Matthew uses the phrase the kingdom of heaven exclusively. He also uses the expression the kingdom of God. So these are not contrary kind of things. Why would you call it the kingdom of God? Because God sets it up. Why would you call it the kingdom of heaven? Because the God of heaven sets it up. Daniel 2:44 and 45. When Matthew calls it the kingdom of heaven, he's reaching back into Daniel 2, specifically talking about the replacement of the Gentile nations with the literal earthly kingdom of the Messiah. Matthew 3. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness, saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Repent and believe the gospel of the kingdom. Verse 5. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the regions round about Jordan, were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. So the gospel of the kingdom of heaven is that the kingdom's at hand. It's available. Chapter 4, Matthew 4, verse 23. Well, let's do verse 17 first. And from that time, that is from the time, verse 12, Matthew 4, 12, when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. Verse 17, and from that time, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now that's a comparison to Mark 1, verse 14 and 15. Verse 23, Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. So what's the gospel of the kingdom? Repent. The time is fulfilled. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And what does he do? Healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria. And they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those that were possessed with devils, and those that were lunatic, and those that had palsy, and he healed them. The gospel of the kingdom is preached in the midst of signs and wonders that confirm the word that's being preached. If you write down Luke chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, he goes out and he preaches and shows the kingdom of God. That is, he's preaching about this kingdom's at hand, and look, I'm bringing to you the signs that demonstrate I'm the deliverer, I'm the Messiah. The two great categories of sign, physical healing and power over unclean spirits, casting out the devils. That's the two signs God gave Moses in Exodus chapter 4. When Moses says, "Go tell Pharaoh, let my people go." And Moses says, "They're not going to believe that." He's talking about Israel. "They're not going to follow me." He said, "I'll give you two signs to show that I'm sent you." And one was handling serpents, taking up the serpent, satanic power over Satan and his program. And two was the healing of his hand to turn to leprosy. Those two signs, because in the kingdom, God's going to deliver Israel from satanic captivity and also from the corruption of sin, the bondage of corruption that creation's in. And he's going to deliver creation from satanic captivity and the bondage of sin, the corruption of sin. And in that kingdom, Isaiah 33 says, the inhabitants of his kingdom will no more say, "I am sick." He'll take Satan, bind him, put him in the bottom of his pit, and throw all of his evil spirits out of the land, Zechariah 13 says. By the way, we've been studying this in some detail in the book of Mark, so those of you that haven't been here in the book of Mark, you need to get those studies and listen to them. But what those things they do is they confirm the word of the kingdom. Jesus wasn't going about healing people just because, you know, Alex talking about Terry Martelloni in the hospital with COVID. Mary Castiello had COVID this week or two ago, month ago. You're back at work this more than a week or two. You know, a lot of you folks have had COVID, and my wife and I had it, and we didn't, you know, heal. We didn't do any of that. Well, in my house, when you say heal, you think the dog's going to come and get it at your feet, because that's, you know. Anyway, people think that divine intervention and healing is something that he did just because there were sick people. He did it to confirm the word, the preaching of the kingdom. It wasn't just a matter of go make people bad. You know, I don't feel good, and I'm going to get the preacher to heal me. That's the illegitimate use of passages in the Bible that have nothing to do with what the Bible's talking about. But you need to understand why they're there. It has to do with being demonstrating the kingdom of God is there. So that gospel of the kingdom is what Christ preached. What did Jesus preach when he was here? He preached the gospel of the kingdom. The time is fulfilled. Prophecy is in operation, being fulfilled. And Israel needed to repent for the kingdom. It's the issue. All men pray. That's the issue now. Look at chapter 9, Matthew 9. Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. By the word, when it says every, then you know that it's not like what people do today. People use that verse and give you hope that maybe, possibly, perhaps, you might get healed. And when it doesn't happen, you look at the verse and say, well, maybe God doesn't love me because that verse didn't work in my life. It didn't work because I didn't know what God's doing today. And you need to understand that. But what was working at that time was the kingdom of God was available, being pressed. The Messiah was here. Look at Matthew 24, verse 14. Now, this is important to understand this one also. Matthew 24, talking about the last days. Talking about over at the end of the chart over here. You take out the dispensation of grace. Because we're talking about prophecy. That which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. We're not talking about what was kept secret. So now we have Christ is ministering in here, looking toward this time of Jacob's trouble. We'll look in a minute in Matthew chapter 3, verse 7, when Jesus talks to the Pharisees back here. He said, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? The ministry of Christ back here is looking to prepare this little flock for those days right there. Matthew 24, in those, when he gives you the Olivet Discourse, when he talks about what's going to come after his in the ages to come, verse 14, this gospel of the kingdom. Now, what's the gospel of the kingdom? The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Prophecy, the prophetic clock, we're going to be in the seventh week. We know where we are. And the kingdom is the issue. This gospel of the kingdom should be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Verse 13, he that endureth to the end shall be saved. The end of what? Well, verse 15, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation as spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand, then flee. The abomination that maketh desolate is the last verse in Daniel chapter 9. It's the thing with the Antichrist over here. When this the seventh week of Daniel is being fulfilled, that's what you do. The context is tribulation, seventh week. The context of Matthew 23, verse 24, verse 13, he that endureth to the end shall be saved, has not endured to the end of your life and been able to die and go to heaven. Now, I was taught that as a kid in the church I was raised in, the denomination I was raised in. Some of you were too. That's not what the context is. When he says, this gospel of the kingdom should be preached in all nations, then shall the end come, that's not. If we get the gospel to everybody in the world today, Jesus will come back. The context is that seventh week of Daniel. So when you see that, you say, well, okay, I got that. Now that kingdom, come back with me, if you will, to the book of Jeremiah, just for a second. Understand that the kingdom they're talking about is the kingdom that God had promised to the nation Israel. Jeremiah 23. Woe unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, saith the Lord. So the leaders of Israel have failed the nation. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, against the pastors that feed my people, ye have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not visited them. Behold, I will visit upon you the evil of your doing. I'm going to take the kingdom from you and give it to another group. And I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all countries. So he's still got a flock. Whether I have driven them and will bring them again into their folds, and they shall be fruitful and increased. And I will set up shepherds over them, which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed. Neither shall they be lacking, saith the Lord. He's telling the leaders of Israel, I'm going to replace you dudes with some faithful leaders. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch. There's the Messiah. A king shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and justice. What are those last three words? In the earth. This is a literal, physical, Davidic kingdom in the earth. headquartered at Jerusalem. Jesus said, don't swear by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king. But it's going to be a kingdom of righteousness. So Jesus tells his preaching back here, he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Now come with me, if you will, to the book of Luke, chapter 12. And by the way, while you're turning to Luke chapter 12, just keep turning over to chapter 18 just for a second, Luke 18. And understand something. And I know this is Sunday morning, and you know you go to Sunday morning church, you're supposed to get all pumped up to get you through the week. You didn't come here for that because you know that's not what we do. Why don't you get your feet grounded in something that'll help you? If I juiced you up today, it'd last till about 3 o'clock this afternoon, when you heard the score of the Bears game. You know, something like that. We got a brother visiting with us this morning. He's parked in the parking lot when we got here. And my wife said, who's that? I said, well, I don't know, somebody in a Cadillac. That's too bad for them. But at least he's a fan of the right ball team. Got a Sox tag on his car. I'm not going to identify him because they make him an enemy for some of you. But I said, well, at least he knows who to root for in baseball. But when you hear the score sometime, you go, juicing you up emotionally won't do. Believe that. I asked my wife about her ball team yesterday. Luke 18, verse number 31. Now he's talking to people who've been preaching the gospel of the kingdom for at least 3 years. Then he took unto him the 12 and said unto them, behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man shall be fulfilled. So we're in the prophetic program. For he shall be delivered unto the Gentiles, and shall be mocked, and spitefully entreated, and spitted on. They shall scourge him, put him to death, and the third day he'll rise again. And they praised God for what he said, and said, this is what we've been preaching to Israel, and it's the only hope we have. Hello, preacher. Oh, say that loud.
Hello, preacher.
Preachers read that passage like that all the time, and you just sit there and go, oh. See what verse 34 says? They understood none of these things. What didn't they understand? They was going to die and be resurrected. This saying was hid from them. Neither knew they the things which were spoken. Now tell me something. What's the gospel of salvation today? Paul said, I delivered unto you the gospel that I preached to you, how that Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, was buried, and was raised again the third day according to Scripture, and he was seen. The gospel of your salvation is that Jesus Christ went to Calvary, died for your sins, was buried, and raised again for your justification. The gospel of your salvation is based on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They don't even know he's going to die. How could they have been preaching the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ as good news? If they don't even know he's going to die, how could they preach that he died for our sins? They didn't. The content of the message they preach has nothing to do with the content of the gospel we preach today. And if you go back here and try to do what they're doing, you're going to preach a message that isn't what God has you to preach today. That's why this is serious. You're talking about the difference between heaven and hell for people you know. This is not just talking about what church you go to. This is talking about where you spend eternity. You can rest on that thing. That's why it's serious. That's why this is not something you just say, we'll talk about this on a Tuesday night Bible class or Wednesday night Bible class, but this is something you need to have clear in your mind. Because this is not the gospel of the grace of God that they're preaching. They don't even know about it. That Christ's going to die. And yet they've been preaching the gospel of the kingdom for all these years. You've got to understand, folks, this is serious stuff. So what's the gospel of the kingdom designed to accomplish? Look at Luke chapter 12. It's going to do what Jeremiah 23 is talking about. Luke 12, verse number 31. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock. That's that flock back in Jeremiah 23. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. what he's doing with the gospel of the kingdom is he's gathering a believing remnant among the apostate nation. He's gathering what he calls the little flock. Now, hold your hand there and compare that to Matthew 21. Because when it says he's going to give you the kingdom, that's something very significant. In Matthew 21, Jesus told a parable. And it was aimed at the religious leaders of the nation. In fact, in verse 45, when the chief priests and Pharisees had heard his parable, they perceived that he spake of them. They got it. Notice what he said about them in verse number 42. Jesus said unto them, did ye never read in the Scripture, the stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner? This is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes. Therefore I say unto you, the religious leaders of Israel, the builders of the nation, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation. Notice, not the nations, not the Gentiles, which is the way people read that verse. The kingdom of God is going to be taken from the apostate leaders of the nation and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof. Repent and bring forth the fruits meet for repentance. Fear not, little flock, it's your little flock. Who are the believers? The people who believe the gospel of the kingdom. I'm going to give you the king. What he's doing is he's gathering together the administrative governmental structure for his future kingdom. Look at Matthew 19. Verse 27. Then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee. What shall we have therefore? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, that you which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit upon the throne of his glory, right here, what are they going to be doing? You shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. God had told Israel in the prophets, I'll restore your judges. I'll put princes back over you. And Israel always, go back to the book of Judges and the book of Numbers, they had a leader in every tribe. And he said, I'm going to restore that. And you 12, the reason there are 12 apostles and not 15, the reason there's 12 and not 2, is because there are 12 tribes of the nation Israel. And each is going to be, we're talking about establishing the administrative governmental structure of that nation. If you look at Luke chapter 19, Jesus tells them a parable. Verse 11, 19:11, and as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable because they were not at Jerusalem, and because they thought the kingdom of God should immediately appear. He said unto them, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered to them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. And the citizens hated him and sent a message after him, saying, we will not have this man reign over us. And it's come to pass when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded his servants to be called unto him, to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much each man had gained. And he takes them, and the guy with the 10, the guy with the 5, and what does he do with them? Verse number 17. And he said unto him, well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in very little, have thou authority over 10 cities. He does the same in verse 19. He said likewise unto him, be thou also over 5 cities. You see, what he's done, he's got a group of people here that he's gathered together, this little flock. He's going to go away, receive the kingdom, just like Daniel chapter 7 says he will, and then he's going to come back over here after this period of time and set his kingdom up, and the people that are in this little flock that endure through this time based upon their fidelity here, are going to receive authority over cities. Over, he's building his administrative structure. Imagine one day in the kingdom, the mayor of the city of Chicago is going to be a saint of the Most High God. How's that going to work out? Well, better than it's working out now. But what he's doing is he's gathering together the administrators of the government that he's going to establish over here. Look, this stuff's real. This stuff's just what it says it is. That's the reason. Go back with me to Matthew chapter 3. This is the reason that in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and the early Acts period, that water baptism is so important in these passages. Matthew chapter 3, verse number 5, then went out to him, to John the Baptist, Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan. Mark 1, 4 says that John was preaching the baptism for repentance for the remission of sins. And were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, when he talks about the baptism for repentance for the remission of sins that John preached, they go out and they're baptized of him. Verse number 7, when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Well, how did you flee from the wrath to come? That's what John's baptism was about. Now think about that. I'm going to flee from this wrath to come over here by being a part of this little flock. And how do I get in that little flock? The door to the little flock, the initiating action into the little flock, was John's baptism, the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Let me show you. Look at Luke chapter number 7. In Luke chapter number 7, Jesus, talking about John the Baptist, says in verse 29, and all the people that heard him, that's John the Baptist, and the publicans justified God. They said, God's right. How? Being baptized with the baptism of John. The baptism of John was an outward sign that you believe the kingdom's coming. We need to get right. John's calling us to repent, and we need to do it. And the believers identified themselves together as believers, as part of the little flock, through John's baptism. Verse 30, but the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against them. How? Being not baptized of him. So the baptism of John, the water baptism, the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, was an identifying mark, the initial identifying mark for the believers. Now hold your hand there and come with me to Acts chapter 13. Because you need to understand that the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins was not just a testimony to join a church. Acts 13, the Apostle Paul says about John, verse 24, when John had first preached before his, the Messiah's coming, the baptism of repentance, notice, to all the people of Israel. This was a national baptism for a national repentance. John is not just calling you, 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 and you. He's calling the nation Israel to repent. And the believers in the nation that repent are going to be the true nation. What's going to happen to the rest of them? Go back to Matthew 3. The wrath to come is going to get them. Matthew chapter 3. Verse number 11. I indeed baptize you with water, John says, unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, that's the Messiah, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Now, when does that take place? Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5, Jesus quotes this passage and says that's what's going to happen on the day of Pentecost. So Jesus Christ, on the day of Pentecost, he's exalted, he's at the Father's right hand, and he pours out the Spirit on them. Jesus Christ from heaven baptizes the believing remnant of Israel with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Now, when did that take place? Well, it hadn't yet, because that's the wrath to come. Verse 12, whose fan is in his hand, he will thoroughly purge his floor. You see, that's what the tribulation is about. God is going to purge out the rebel out of the nation Israel and only leave the believers. He shall gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. That's why Jeremiah says, what's the chaff to the wheat? You know what's going to happen to the chaff? The unbelievers? People that reject the message? That wrath, and when Christ comes back in flaming fire, he'll destroy them. And only the believers go into the kingdom. There are three baptisms in that one verse. See that? Paul said there's one baptism for us. People say there's only one. No. Every time you see that word baptism, it doesn't mean water. You know, there's a disease called water on the brain, hydrocephalus. Religion's got that. You ask the average denominational preacher about baptism, he won't know there's more than one. And if he does, he might know there's two. There's three in one verse, about a dozen in the Bible. Now, why would that water baptism be so important? Come back with me to Ezekiel chapter number 36, and get Ezekiel 36 in one hand and Exodus chapter 29. Ezekiel 36 and Exodus 29. Ezekiel 36, verse 24. And I will take you from among the nations and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. This is talking about Israel's been scattered. I'm going to regather them. The time has come for them to be regathered. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon... By the way, notice the mode of this. People say baptized, baptism means immersion, not in the Bible. I just made enemies out of two-thirds of the audience, but in your Bible, baptism is administered in two ways. One is sprinkling, and one is pouring. When he baptized them with the Spirit in Acts chapter 2, he poured his Spirit on them. Here he said, I'm going to sprinkle you with clean water. So we've got Methodists and Presbyterians liking that. Everybody else said, oh, that's not right, preacher. And you should be clean. Now, what are they going to be cleansed from? From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. Listen, if the blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin, the water system can't either. Water baptism was a ceremonial cleansing. From what? From the filthiness of the idolatrous system of false doctrine. That is, you're identifying yourself saying, that's false. I want to be separated from it. Now, the reason for that, go back with me to Exodus chapter 19. Who is Israel? Exodus 19, verse number 5. Now, therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. So when God chose, formed Israel as a nation, he formed them to be a holy, set apart, separate nation. No other nation in the earth belonged to God. They're his portion. Numbers says they're not to be reckoned among the nations. They're separate. Holy means set apart. But they're set apart to be a kingdom of priests. So Israel's kingdom had to do with being priest. Now in Exodus 29, when God established the priesthood in Israel, he established some procedures to set someone apart for the priesthood office. Exodus 29, this is the thing which thou shalt do unto them to hallow them, to make them holy, to minister unto me in the priest office. So how can someone be set apart to be holy in the priest office? Verse number 4, Aaron and his sons shalt thou bring into the door of the tabernacle, the congregation, and shall wash them with water. The first thing you did to bring someone into the priesthood is you brought them to the laver there in front of the tabernacle and you washed them, took that water and put it on, you baptized them. Water baptism was the initiating rite of cleansing that puts for the priesthood. Verse 7, then shalt thou take the anointing oil and pour it upon his head and anoint him. The oil, of course, a type of the Holy Spirit. So the first thing they did is they set them apart through the cleansing, the purification from the idolatry by setting them apart as the believing remnant, the water baptism. And then he's going to anoint them with the Holy Spirit. By the way, at Pentecost, when the leaders of Israel asked Peter what to do, he said, repent you. The fact that I can't quote Acts 2:38 tells you that my COVID brain is working. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Change your mind about it. You crucified the wrong guy. Change your mind about that. And be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. He takes the two things that are required to get in the priest's office, says that's the two things you've got to be, because you're going to be the kingdom of priest. You're going to be this holy nation. You're going to be God's kingdom people in the earth. What he's doing is he's providing. So this little flock can function as the kingdom of priests. And that's exactly what they're to be. I get Isaiah chapter 61 and 1 Peter chapter, 1 Peter chapter 2. Isaiah 61. Verse number 6, talking about, referring to the kingdom here. You remember verse 1 and 2 of Isaiah 61, Jesus quotes in Luke chapter 4, and in the middle of verse 2, he stops. It says to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and he shut the book in the synagogue of Nazareth. And he said, this day that scripture is fulfilled in your ears. What he didn't read was, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn, because that wasn't fulfilled back there. That's second coming. So what's going to happen after the day of vengeance? Verse 6, ye shall be named the priest of the Lord. Men shall call you the ministers of our God. You shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory shall you boast yourself. Israel is going to be a kingdom of priests. They're going to be the one who takes the message of God out and teaches the word to the nations. That's why Matthew 28 says, go ye therefore and teach all nations. That's Israel teaching the Gentiles in the kingdom. 1 Peter chapter 2. That's what the little flock that Peter ministered to is identified as. 1 Peter chapter 2. Now, I understand that this passage is used by the Protestant church to teach the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer. But that's not what this passage talks about. And the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer is a good anti-Catholic Protestant doctrine, talking about the individual right to talk to God. But you're not a priest, folks. I'm sorry. You don't qualify. You're members of Christ. You don't need a priest. Anyway, 1 Peter chapter, who's this book written to? It's written to the strangers. Written to the nation of Israel. Read the first verse in the book. And ye are a 1 Peter 2:9. Ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people. Isn't that what we just read about in Exodus 19 that Israel is? Yeah. That little flock that he chose back there, your father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom, they are that chosen generation. They are the royal priesthood. They're the holy nation. They're the peculiar people. That's what's going on over there. And that's what Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is gathering together and preparing. And listen, when you get preachers talking about water baptism, talking about being priest, and talking about for Christ and his kingdom, listen, they don't know what they're talking about as far as the text of Scripture is concerned. You listen. Now, we're on the radio 6 days a week on WYLL. I listen to I listen to the radio station, and I hear people talk about, well, for, you know, 20 years ago, they wouldn't say lost people. They'd say unchurched. Now they don't say lost people. You're not a believer. You're a Christ follower. What in the Sam Hill is that? Gandhi was a Christ follower. We're image bearers. My question, I asked the guy talking to the radio station, Alex, I'm meeting with some of them. I said, well, whose image are you bearing? Well, the image of God. I said, Genesis 5 said Adam had children in his image. Did you know you weren't created in the image of God? Adam was, but you weren't. God didn't create you. He created Adam. Your mom and dad created you. I mean, do you understand how God created humanity to expand? There was no special act of divine creation for you like there was in Genesis 2, verse 7 for Adam, for mankind. Anyway, all this talk, the ongoing of the people today went down to the front. We're going to take an offering, and some dear deacon prayed, Lord, we pray you'd bless these tithes and offering for the ongoing of thy kingdom. When you come in the back of a building and you look up here and there's a baptistry and there's a tithing bucket, you better run. Because you're going to see people they have no idea what God's doing today. Now, they may get some of it right. Thank God if they do, but I bet they don't get much of it right. Because what they do is they take these passages and they don't understand what's going on in them. And when you don't understand what's going on in them, you teach confusion. Look with me. I'm going to quit. 1 Timothy chapter 6. This is why this is important. Because if you fail to rightly divide the word of truth, you make the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ a source of false doctrine, of cynical hope, and of distorted religious rites and traditions. You try to take the gospel that Jesus preached, and you wind up with lordship salvation. You've got to bring forth the fruits meet for repentance, or you're not really a child of God. I read an article just yesterday on one of the prominent evangelical websites that everyone says this is the gospel. And it was 19 proofs that you're saved. And you know what they did? They went through the book of 1 John, which is many tests about whether you're a child, son of God or not. Not one of the tests, if you're saved, not had anything to do with believing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not once did he mention the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ in any of them. Why? Because that's not the message in 1 John. Now, who's 1 John written to? Well, it's written by John. What did John say in Galatians 2, verse 9? He saw the ministry given to Paul, Peter, James, and John did, and they said, we'll go to the circumcision, and you go to the Gentiles. So when John made a commitment in Galatians chapter 2, which took place in Acts 15, to limit his ministry to the circumcision, who do you think he wrote 1 John to? Now, I know that's brain surgery for a lot of people. Oh, you're getting too complicated, Brother Rick. But when you go in 1 John, he says, if you don't do this, you don't do this, you don't do this, it's because you're not in the family. How do you get in the family? Do this, do this. You know where you get your assurance for yourself? You know how you know you have eternal life as a present possession, your sins are forgiven, you're going to go to heaven when you die? Because you've trusted Jesus Christ's death at Calvary for your payment for your sin, his resurrection is your life. You've trusted him to be the Savior. He died and rose again for you to be. And your life hadn't got anything to do with it. Amen. And when you make your life have something to do with it, you've got nothing but uncertainty. Because your life isn't worth a hill of beans. Isaiah 64 says it's filthy rags. Look that one up in the Hebrew and see what it means. I mean, that's worse than the stuff you're stepping over in the parking lot out there. I'm not mad at you. I'm just trying to say this is important. When you don't rightly divide the earthly ministry of Christ, you wind up with a cynical type hope. People say, well, you know, maybe God will heal you. That isn't what those verses said. Maybe God will answer your prayer. That's not what the verses said. said, ask and you'll receive. Knock and you'll hear. Seek and you'll find. He said, it will. Well, maybe. No, don't. There's no maybe, if, bounds, or but. It'll work in its place. And then you wind up with a bunch of distorted religious rites, water ceremonies, confessing sins, all that kind of stuff. You know where the priesthood and the confessional and all that stuff, it comes from distorting the Word of God. Now, why does that happen? 1 Timothy chapter 3. If any man teach otherwise, and that is what you've been reading here, and consent not to wholesome words. That word wholesome means it's wholesome, it's good. Wheaties, he's eating his Wheaties. He's eating something good and solid. Life-giving, health. You want something to give you some spiritual health? There's some words. Even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, by that verse and that phrase, write down 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37. Because Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37, if any man think himself to be spiritual or prophet, you think you're speaking for God, you think you're being led by the Spirit of God, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Because God has changed his program from back there to where we are today. If this thing doesn't fall down on me. He's changed the program. And we're not back there, we're here. And you Gentiles, Paul said, I speak to you Gentiles inasmuch as I am the apostle of Gentiles, I magnify my office. We're Gentiles, folks. Paul's the apostle of Gentiles. Where do you go get Gentile information in your Bible? You don't go back here to a place where Christ said, don't go to the Gentiles. You go to where Christ sent somebody to the Gentiles. And Paul said, the words that I'm speaking to you are the words of Christ. You seek a proof of Christ speaking in me, there it is, right there. And he said, if you don't consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ that are being preached and taught by me, and to the doctrine that's according to godliness, the only place you can get doctrine today that produces godliness is in Paul's epistles. Now, why do you do that? Verse 5, 4, he is proud, knowing nothing. He's a proud ignoramus. I didn't say that, folks. I'm just quoting Paul. But doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw thyself. If that's not a description of modern-day evangelicalism or the church for 2,000 years from now till Paul, I haven't read church history. I don't read what's going on. And see, the problem starts out with he's proud. Knowing nothing. That doesn't mean he doesn't have any. He might have 15 degrees. He might have more degrees than it's got temperature. He's not talking about ignorance in the sense of not knowing. He doesn't know about what God's doing. Because the only way you learn that is in that book, Rightly Divided. And he said, you know what you do? Don't be part of that. Stay away from it. When people use the Bible but aren't dispensational, they abuse the Bible and they wind up abusing you. So what was Christ actually teaching? He was actually preaching the kingdom program. He was actually teaching prophecy. The time is fulfilled. Repent and believe the gospel of the kingdom. He was preaching a message that has to do with God's plan and purpose in the earth through the nation Israel be brought to fulfillment over there. He wasn't preaching this that we are today. You get that separated in your mind, and that book will become an open book to you. And the burden that you bear for not doing it will be lifted. And the clarity. Listen, you won't understand every piece of it. You'll just have it all. You'll just know where it goes. But you can have God's word work effectually in you. You can have peace with God today not based on what you do, not based on you that have followed me forsaken all, but based upon what Jesus Christ did for you at Calvary. And it'll be enough. And you won't worry about some famous preacher coming along preaching the gospel according to Jesus says you have to make him Lord of your life and promise him perfect obedience or you can't be saved. You'll say, I never would obey him perfectly. I never have, and until he gives me a new body, I never will. But it's his faithfulness that I'm trusting, not mine. You can have peace. Take a deep breath and relax and say, now I let the love of Christ constrain me. Because I thus judge, I think like he thinks. In your Christian life, when you face difficulties and problems, when you face the failures, you don't say, oh, I need to go and beg my humble myself and beg God to forgive. You say, you know, Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago saw that dumb thing that I just did, and he died for it before I ever did it. Shame on me for having it in my life. That doesn't belong in my life. Get out of my life. And you put it off. And you stop because you can. Because Calvary sets you free. And you can put in its place the works of righteousness. Put on the new man. And you know how to deal with that stuff. And when you do, you begin to walk in the newness of life. That's the key. The rising red hand on the face of the studio clock says, shut up, Richard. So that's the message. Don't be confused about what Christ is doing in time past so you can have clarity about what he's doing now. If you've never trusted him as your Savior, if you've never just relied on him, you thought religion was going to get you there. You thought what you were going to do, you thought ignoring it was going to get you there. Listen, trust him. There's a song that's become real popular recently. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. Father, we thank you today for your love and your grace, for the depth of it, the reality of it, that it would touch us. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the ability to understand it the way you've designed it to be understood. The freedom to question the assumptions of religion and put our faith in what saith the Scripture. And I pray as we do that, that we honor you, that you'd magnify your word above all things, so that the life of Jesus Christ might be put on display in our thinking, our understanding, for your glory in Christ's name. Amen.